What if coding was just a conversation? Not in some distant future, but right now.
Imagine a world where the highly skilled specialists that are usually computer software engineers become middle managers, overseeing an army of bots. Imagine everybody having the power and capability to create their own software tools for exactly the thing that they want to do and exactly the way that they want to do it. Some people seem to think that this is a world that's already emerging right before our eyes. This isn't just changing how we build software, it's changing who gets to build software. And this democratization scares some people. What happens when everybody has the power to create whatever software tools they want? See, all code is an abstraction over the same type of binary information. The push to be more human has been this like ongoing fight that technologists have been having since the beginning of human-computer interaction. From punch cards to assembly code to Python to the more recent trends of WYSIWYG website builders and no-code automation tools. Now, revolutions with large language models offer an alternative approach in which AI is not only able to infer our intent, but also handle massive amounts of contextual information and output working lines of code faster than you can read them. A new term, vibecoding, is taking hold, coined by Andre Karpathy, describing this very laissez-faire approach to writing code, where you offload the actual work to the bots and you just go along with the vibes. Critics of vibecoding say that it produces sloppy code, that it's no better than blindly copying and pasting from Stack Overflow. Yeah, it can be. For me personally, this has removed this lifelong friction between the ideas in my head and being able to make them something that other people can use. Sequence was started in 2021 to create a collaborative video production platform that can handle high-end video projects from pre to post-production. One thing has become very clear to us as we've worked on Sequence for these last couple of years, which is that there is no simple MVP of Sequence. If we are promising to be this unifying hub of all stages of production, those people who are in those stages of production use very specialized professional tools today, we simply have to build all of that. We have to create the cloud rendering and the streaming technology, and we have to build a next generation nonlinear editor, and we have to build a media management library and workflow tools, screenwriting tools, storyboarding tools. Basically, we just have to build a ton of product. AI made our small team much more capable. It's allowed me as a designer to have more impact because I'm starting to just design and code once a beat. These are just things that I want to explore with the team. In software development, there is this idea called pair programming. Engineers will sit side by side working together to solve a problem. One person is the driver writing the code line by line. And you got the navigator giving you advice on your code, reviews as you write things up. It acknowledges the fact that coding happens at the different level. You've got the micro level of the details, syntax, but then you've also got the very high level thinking at the same time. Except as a human, you can really only inhabit one at a time. AI pull up a pair programmer with you at any time. In the 1999 book, The Pragmatic Programmer, there's a story told of a developer who carries around a rubber duck with them everywhere they go. Whenever they get stuck on a problem, they pull out the rubber duck, they put it on their desk, and they just explain their code to the duck. It's called rubber duck debugging. The act of articulating your thoughts to another helps you gain clarity in the problem that you're trying to face to begin with. And I find this happening all the time with AI. As I'm just kind of outlining a basic problem, I often find that I have a new level of clarity that I didn't have when I started writing the message. What happens when the duck can talk back to you? When it isn't just an inanimate thing, but it's an interactive thing. But look, I'm just an idea guy. What do I know? I think we'll get a better sense of what's going on with this whole vibe coding thing by talking to the talented engineering team of Sequence, who I find always has a grounded approach to new technology.
Vibe coding works a lot. But then when you want it to really work, when it matters most, it will fail you. And I'm also in the camp, I think, that finds it kind of cringe, the term. I mean, I completely welcome the AI overlords taking over eventually. You can vibe code, and then eventually they'll solve the context problem, but what is generated in most of the cases is slop. and it requires refinement.
Boom. Fucking refined.
All right, Heli. Hip, hip.
They were scary. The numbers were scary.
Seeing GitHub Copilot, I remember being like, oh my gosh, this is going to change everything. Back then it was just kind of like tab auto-completing. I had to take some JSON and reformat it into a bunch of like nested like CSS, and something that like I could do by hand. And I just knew that because there were like some recursive loops in it that it would just take forever. I remember like writing the function name and it was like convert JSON to CSS or something like that, just like a super generic name, and then like plugged in the argument for the function, and then it just like generated the right thing. But it didn't get any of the nested fields in the JSON and convert those to the CSS that I needed. I then just changed the name of the function to like convert complex nested JSON to CSS. And then it immediately went in and like added the recursion necessary to actually go through each of the nested fields. And it worked. And I was like, that just saved me 30, 40 minutes of just get into the nitty gritty of doing this loop that I didn't want to spend my time doing. I just needed to get some styles into the application. And that to me was definitely the first moment where I felt like my work had been dramatically accelerated.
That aligns a lot with like when I really started to pay attention to this stuff too. As I've been thinking about it, like it feels like there's sort of three distinct eras that we've just gone through insanely rapidly. The GitHub Copilot era of tab to complete, you fundamentally still had to like understand the code that you were writing. And then there was the second era, chat with your code base or chat with your code components. And then there's now of the composer agent world where it's just doing like 1,000 line diffs and dozens of file edits at once. How has this been affecting your work?
I remember before there was the paid version of ChatGPT, there was also GitHub Copilot because OpenAI. And I remember almost immediately turning that off. It would hallucinate like bot properties and APIs and just like, it would get in the way more than it would help. And then we entered kind of that second era. And that's when I really like leaned in to LLMs. And I was like, okay, this is so useful in talking about complex operations. And like, it was super helpful as like an investigator, as a collaborator. This third era, I actually feel like has been detrimental to the progress of code in general.
Back in my early Windows Debugger days, back when the tools came out where you could build your UI in a tool which would do the code generation for you, you just had to hook in your logic. That was really powerful, really useful. But then the APIs changed and it just became much more natural just to do everything by hand. Those were the earliest days. 5 years ago, Copilot came out, hitting tab rather than typing out the function signature. That really saved me a lot of time. For some things, AI is like a shotgun. It's like you just point and shoot and it just like blasts away everything you need. I don't have that luck with the kind of work that I do. I work in systems programming. It's not a shotgun for me. It's like a dagger. But sometimes that dagger stabs me in the back. Last weekend when I was doing some code and innocently, like I'm just making it write comments for me. But for some reason, it just kind of changed the structure without me knowing or approving that change. Or maybe I did approve it unknowingly. It's like that's what I say. It's like a stab in the back. So yeah, I can't use it to like blast away major parts of code. It's my dagger, but it can be dangerous.
You can do great refactors with it if you really understand it, but you can easily get into loops if you don't. Understanding and reading and following the flow will get you much further than just outsourcing thinking. And I think that's a very dangerous trap. When you forget, you can take a step back and like revisit the problem. I think that's where vibe coding kind of falls apart, is like you're vibing too hard is actually a possibility. You can always say it's a skill issue. Like, yes, everything is a skill issue. If you're bad at prompting, you're not going to get good results. If you're good at prompting and you understand it, I think you'll go further.
I've been thinking about this less with AI and more with talking about scaling a team and hiring. An opinion kind of mirrors my gut reaction here, which is like a faster engine is powerful, but it still requires like thoughtful direction. You can go fast, but if you're going the wrong way, you're still going the wrong way. You're still building the wrong product. You're still building the wrong features. And so having agent collaborators that can do code reviews or can help build integration tests or even full features would be empowering, I think. It would be really exciting. because it would leave, you know, you and I more time to be thinking about the product experience, the details, maybe obsessing over the pixels. That it would be hard to explain, like, optical alignment to an AI the same way, like, you or I, after years of being in crib, just like have, like,
yeah, everyone's always like worried about if AI is going to take away, like, the fun part of creativity from a design background, not a development background. Like, that's where AI makes development so fun. Once I've planned the feature, shared all the relevant code files and, like, research that I've done, it will create a structure and interactions and logic that I care about to make it work. And then from there, you're just like, oh, I'm going to go play with a bunch of Tailwind classes and make it feel nice.
Audio equalizer. We had spec'd out like 2 weeks. It was Valentine's Day. I didn't have anything going on that night. So I was like, I'm gonna use a couple hours and try to figure out how far can I take this using AI. And I ended up basically building out and exceeding the spec that we had just put together earlier that day in a matter of hours. It was the fastest I think we've ever shipped anything. So that was a pretty transformational moment. We go back to V0. I had a pretty solid idea of what we actually wanted to build. Done a bunch of research into different audio equalizers, kind of understanding the math and the UI and like what we wanted. I was able to give it very, very specific prompts. So the first prompt was create a bell curve graph using Canvas. And I ended up with this in one shot. It was like, I don't know, consist like normal looking, formal distribution. Here, I knew that I could go and I can continuously prompt this and ask follow-ups to basically start adding all the controls that I wanted. So if we go to version 2, add controls for the amplitude, the height of the curve, and the width. Cool. You wire this in and now you have this interactive. And then we go to version 3. I basically said at this point, hey, we're going to turn this into our audio equalizer. So like, this is where it actually kind of pulled in some of the audio engineering knowledge, such as a Q factor, a frequency range, adapt our single band to accommodate a number of bands. Let's use a picker to choose what band we're editing. And then I gave it a default configuration. And so this was super great because normally you would have to just basically rip out a bunch of code that you had previously written, abstract it so you could make it a little bit more reusable. And this was able to just do it instantly, really quickly. Now we have a band picker, but they're not all drawn at the same time. This is where I went next, was basically say, hey, allow us to draw a curve at half opacity for each of the individual and then draw the combination curve. So this is already really starting to look like what you would see in an audio EQ component. I kept iterating on this, changing the styles and adding some more interactivity until I got to V11. It was like the version that, this was like within an hour of where I basically got to the specs of what we had done in our product requirement document, where basically I'm gonna have direct manipulation on the controls, set the number of bands, and then we had the combined response frequency curve and all the individual ones. And this is basically what we spec'd out. And now I just need to convert it to Svelte and put it into our app. This is actually what it looks like. And as a sequence component. And yeah, we put this together in days, not weeks.
And here you can see the final EQ being used on this video. So we've seen how vibecoding can drastically speed up development, reduce development costs, allow you to get through lots of ideas quicker. But at the same time, it can introduce new complexities, confusion, and frustration to both the product and the development process, especially if you just kind of like get lazy and turn your brain off.
You're
vibing
too
hard, remember. I think the thing that's making me the most excited is the way that it's empowering anybody on the team to just design in code. One of the biggest points of collaboration that people have been trying to like fix in the development process was the design to development handoff and the specing process. Like basically the point where the designer would draw a bunch of static screens and then they would draw a bunch of labels and instructions over those screens to try to explain to a developer how to build it. And this just seems wildly inefficient these days. Like now, whether it's the CEO on his spare time or me building a script writing tool to try to like prove that we should have script writing tools in sequence, or just any of us needing to like show our ideas, it makes so much more sense to just build something in code and then thoughtfully integrate it into the app rather than just drawing a bunch of pictures and asking someone else to build. A couple days ago, I mentioned to Luke how what I would really love to do in order to like build out our full vision of Sequence is get to a point where we were just prototyping a new app or interface or surface on top of our core editing capabilities like every week. We would do this, I don't know, an entire summer in order to figure out like what is the ideal version of sequence. That time might be quickly approaching. It turns out that vibecoding can create pretty incredible products, but you just still have to do the hard human work anyways. You can read more about our process on the Sequence blog, or you can subscribe to us here and leave a comment if you would like to see more videos about what our development process is like here at Sequence. And, you know, maybe if it's the type of thing that you're really good at.
Hiring. We're hiring really talented engineers. So if you want to work on hard problems like building multiplayer sync, building really high performance front ends, and you want to be able to move even faster using AI, you know where to find us, sequence.film.